In this mini lecture, I'm going to introduce the basics about idols. And if you're a big K-pop fan, you already know all of this already, but you might want to listen because the video is really short and it'll sort of show you where my emphasis is and what I think is the most important things that somebody in the class might need to know.
What is an idol? How are idols created? And what role do they play in the Korean media scape? First, how are idols produced and packaged, and what responsibilities do they have? Idols are the most prominent characteristic of the Korean mass media. So, how are they found? Well, pre-trainee, somebody may take an interest in becoming a celebrity. They see them on TV every day, right? And they can become a trainee through auditions, street casting, or scouting agents. Scouting agents used to be about finding people on the street or in a school, but these days, many scouting agents work directly with for-profit businesses that teach young people how to do things like sing and dance. Once someone becomes an official trainee, they develop their talents like singing, rapping, and dancing, their personality in terms of etiquette and humor, and of course, things like foreign languages. In the past, there was something nicknamed a slave contract with a long period of time and disadvantageous conditions for the hopeful stars. The efforts of fans and the media attention on the slave contracts has now basically seen an end to this practice. So, how do they debut? Well, there's the traditional debut, and there's debuting through a televised process, such as a competition reality show. Baseline reality is that most idol groups don't last very long. Many don't even last to a second round of releases. Over the past few years, we've seen a change in the types of reality and competition shows, from shows that try to debut a soloist to shows that debut a group, often that is only active for a short time. So, why are groups so important in K-pop? Why is this a characteristic of K-pop? It's because K-pop is manufactured, and it's manufactured to get a large number of fans. And if you put a group of people together, you can combine their diverse strengths. You can have the beautiful one, you can have the one who can write songs, you can have the one who's amazing at rapping, and together they will get more fans. Working in a group also allows an agency to enforce conformity onto the group. So everybody in the group has to work hard, everybody in the group has to do well, because otherwise it reflects negatively on the rest of the group. But having a group of people also allows one person to stick out in various ways. So one person can be moody and quiet, and another person can be quite cheerful and goofy. Having a group also helps with K-pop aesthetics, things like synchronized dance, and it allows people to appear in different platforms. One person is acting in a drama while another person is doing an interview, while another person is hosting a radio show. And we can also see that a group is very useful if one person is sick or injured in the military, busy on a different media platform, or has just decided to leave the group and perhaps the industry entirely. Regardless of some of the problems with the voting process, with some of these shows, these shows have done a great job in creating a group of fans who feel intimately connected to and responsible for the success of various artists, and also just teaching fans to understand and appreciate more about the artistic process, which has been, especially in the case of Show Me the Money, quite important. What is the role that the idols play in the media? Well, a lot of it has to do with intertextuality. In Korea, we see a surprisingly large amount of intertextuality. And what that is basically when one media text is referring to another media text. And you can recognize that when you see BTS incorporating a visual from a previous music video into their current music video. That's to demonstrate this connection to past music, and it's something that fans will immediately identify. But it's also the intertextuality when we see cameos or when we see a Alice in Wonderland theme within a K-pop video. There's intertextuality when we see idols in both fictional and non-fictional context. And the idol becomes the person who links the popular media to the promotional discourse about buying the brand of fried chicken or face cream. And all of this can then create a sense of nostalgia, of familiarity. Intertextuality actually creates rewards, emotional rewards, because the more you watch, the more intertextuality you can understand. And it also demonstrates how this culture, this celebrity culture, is rhizomatic. It's everything is connected together. It's one of the reasons I'm always so astounded when people seem to think that certain artists are above or beyond Hallyu and Korea, because this entire system cannot exist in a vacuum. Each part of the Hallyu industry needs the other part in order to make it this amazing media manifestation that we all enjoy. This entire system is very self-referential, and it's structured in absolute terror that you will stop paying attention, or that you won't understand it the way that the media industry wants you to understand it. So they want to put in text captions and highlight words and phrases and show idols on split screens and all these kinds of things so that you will notice what they want you to see. Finally, and sadly, idol culture has sort of destroyed the distinction between the public and private, and idols are responsible for being on screen all the time.